Good morning all. Today's topic of discussion is schizophrenia. In this class, I will be discussing about what is schizophrenia, what are the types, what are the stages, etiology and pathogenesis. Do you know what is mental disorder? It is a wide range of conditions that affect mood, thinking, and behavior. The common types are depression and schizophrenia. Depression we discussed already. So today's class we will see what is schizophrenia. Schizophrenia, it is a serious mental condition in which people interrupt reality and reality abnormally. Schizophrenia may result in some combination of hallucination, delusion, and extremely disordered thinking and behavior that impair daily functioning and can be disabling. Schizophrenia is derived from a Greek word which means split mind. And schizophrenia is a mental disorder characterized by abnormality in the perception or expression of reality. People with schizophrenia often have problem doing well in society, at work, at school, and in relationships. Okay, patient might feel threatened and withdrawn and could appear to have lost touch with reality. Thus, lifelong disease cannot be cured but can be controlled with proper treatment. Okay, now we'll see what are the causes or etiology of schizophrenia. There are many factors which contribute to schizophrenia. We'll see one by one. First one is genetic factors. Schizophrenia tend to run in families, but not single gen is thought to be responsible. It is more likely that different combinations of genes make people more vulnerable to the condition. However, having these genes does not necessarily mean you will develop schizophrenia. Evidence that the disorder is partially inherited comes from studies of twins. Identical twins share same genes. In identical twins, if a twin develops schizophrenia, the other twin has a 1 in 2 chance of developing it. That means 50% of chance. Second one is environmental events. It can trigger schizophrenia in people who are already genetically at risk for this disorder. I will give you some example. For example, infection during development in mother's womb or stressful psychological experiences may increase the risk of developing schizophrenia later in life. Okay. Third one is substance abuse or drug abuse. Drugs actually do not directly cause schizophrenia, but studies have shown drug misuse increases the risk of developing schizophrenia or similar illness. Certain drugs, particularly cannabis or amphetamines, cocaine, these are the drugs. It can trigger symptoms of schizophrenia in people who are susceptible. Using cocaine or amphetamine can lead to psychosis and can cause a relapse in people recovering from an earlier episodes of schizophrenia. Research has shown that teenagers and young adults who use cannabis regularly are more likely to develop schizophrenia in later adulthood. Okay, that's about causes or etiology of schizophrenia. Now we'll see what is pathogenesis or mechanism of schizophrenia. Studies using brain imaging techniques. You know what is fMRI? That is functional magnetic resonance imaging, and PET scan. It is nothing but position emission tomography. Okay, so studies using these techniques have shown functional differences in brain activity in the frontal lobe, hippocampus, and temporal lobes of brain. And pathogenesis of schizophrenia can be explained by three theories. They are dopamine hypothesis, glutamatergic dysfunction, serotonin or 5-HT abnormalities. We will see one by one. First one is dopaminergic hypothesis. Psychosis may result from hyper or hyperactivity of dopaminergic processes in the specific brain regions. This may include the presence of dopamine receptor defect. Positive symptoms may be more closely associated with dopamine receptor hyperactivity in the brain. Negative symptoms and cognitive symptoms may be closely related to dopamine receptor hypofunction in the prefrontal cortex hypofunction. Okay, that's about dopamine hypothesis. Second one is glutamatergic dysfunction. A deficiency of glutamatergic activity produces symptoms similar to those of dopaminergic hyperactivity and possibly symptoms seen in schizophrenia. According to third theory, serotonin or 5-HT abnormalities, schizophrenic patient with abnormal brain scans have higher whole blood 5-HT concentration, and this concentration correlates with increased ventricular size. So according to third theory, suggesting it, telling that there is more amount of 5-HT or serotonin in the blood. Okay, so that's about pathogenesis of schizophrenia. Now we'll see what are the clinical manifestations or signs and symptoms associated with schizophrenia. Okay, so all the signs and symptoms may vary from one person to another. Okay, so this clinical manifestations or signs and symptoms include positive, negative, and cognitive symptoms. We'll see one by one. First one is positive symptoms. Positive symptoms are highly exaggerated ideas, perceptions, or actions that shows the person cannot tell what is real from what is not. Here, the word positive means the presence rather than absence of symptoms. They include delusion, hallucinations, thought disorder, and disorganized behavior. Okay. Second one is negative symptoms. Negative symptoms refers to absence or lack of normal mental function involvement, that is thinking, behavior, and perception of a person. Okay, so we'll see one by one. These negative symptoms include loss of interest in everyday activities, appearing to lack emotion, reduced ability to plan or carry out activities, neglect of personal hygiene, social withdrawal, or loss of motivation. So these are the positive and negative symptoms associated with schizophrenia. Third one is cognitive symptoms. These symptoms reflect how well person's brain learns, stores, and uses information. Okay, so cognitive symptoms involve problems with thought process. They are problems with making sense of information, difficulty paying attention, memory problems, learning new things. Okay, these are cognitive symptoms. Also, there are symptoms. We'll see some symptoms especially in teenagers. They are withdrawal from friends and family, drop in performance at school, trouble sleeping, and irritability. Okay, that's about signs and symptoms associated with schizophrenia. So mainly there are three symptoms: positive, negative, and cognitive symptoms. Now we'll see what are the types of schizophrenia. First one is paranoid schizophrenia. Paranoid schizophrenia is most common form of schizophrenia. Okay, so it may develop later in life than other types of schizophrenia. Symptoms include hallucinations and delusion, but patient's speech and emotions may not be affected in this type of schizophrenia. Okay, that's about paranoid schizophrenia. Second type is disorganized schizophrenia. Disorganized schizophrenia it's a type of schizophrenia usually developed when patient they are 15 to 25 years old. Symptoms include disorganized behaviors, thoughts, also short-lasting delusions, hallucinations, etc. Okay, patient may have disorganized speech patterns and other may find it difficult to understand the patient. People with disorganized schizophrenia often show little or no emotions in their facial expressions, voice tone, mannerisms, etc. At times, they have inappropriate emotional responses to the situation, such as laughing at something sad. Okay, that means we can tell it as disorganized schizophrenia. Third type is catatonic schizophrenia. This is rarest schizophrenia diagnosis characterized by unusual, limited, and sudden movements. You may often switch between being very active or well still. Patient may not talk much, and patient may mimic others' speech and movement. So we can call it as catatonic schizophrenia. And next type, fourth type is undifferentiated schizophrenia. If patient diagnosis may have some symptoms of paranoid, first type, and say catatonic schizophrenia. Okay, so, but it does not obviously fit into one of these types. Okay, patient shows signs of both paranoid and catatonic schizophrenia, but we cannot fit into one of these types. So those patient comes under undifferentiated schizophrenia. And last one is residual schizophrenia. Patient may be diagnosed with residual schizophrenia if they have a history of psychosis but only experiences negative symptoms. Okay, if patient experiences negative symptom and they have a history of psychosis, then this type of patient comes under residual schizophrenia. What are the examples for negative symptoms? Slow movement, poor memory, lack of concentration, poor hygiene, etc. So these are the main types of schizophrenia. Okay. So what are the points we discussed under schizophrenia? What is schizophrenia? What are the causes or etiology of schizophrenia? So 3 points we discussed: genetic factors, environmental factors, and drug abuse. Then we discussed what is pathogenesis. There we explained about three theories: dopaminergic hypothesis, glutaminergic dysfunction, and serotonin or 5-HT abnormalities. Then we discuss what are signs and symptoms or manifestations of schizophrenia. So mainly there are three symptoms, which include positive symptoms, negative symptoms, and cognitive symptoms. Then we discuss what are different types of schizophrenia. There are 5 types: paranoid schizophrenia, disorganized schizophrenia, catatonic schizophrenia, undifferentiated schizophrenia and residual schizophrenia. Okay, so that's about schizophrenia. Hope all of you have understood today's topic, which is schizophrenia. Thank you.